So, can I just get an idea about everyone? Like, how has everyone heard of React? And does anyone have any experience with React, or is everyone a beginner? Can I get that on chat real quick? You can just type yes if you have any experience with React, and no if you're just a complete beginner. Okay, Hari. All right, that's not a problem. We'll cover most of it today. So hopefully by the end of the session, you guys will know a lot about React. So, okay, let's go. Let's see what we'll cover in the session. Today I'll tell you about what React is and why you would want to use React. I will tell you about how it does what it does, and then we'll move on to the basics, and then we'll finish up making the movie library. Yeah. Okay. So React is basically a library that was developed by Facebook, and Facebook uses it on their site. It's maintained and created by Facebook. It's an open source JavaScript library. It's not a framework. Now, something like AngularJS is a framework. But React is not a framework, because a framework is something that tells you to do things in a particular way, whereas React basically just leaves it up to you. You can use it however you want to. It's just like, if you know JavaScript, you'll be very good with React. React is used to make single page applications, and it's the view in the MVC architecture, if you've heard of MVC. MVC stands for Model View Controller. So React takes care of only the view part of that architecture. So for those of you who don't know what a single page application is, let me give you an example here. So let's see. Let's go to amazon.in. Okay. Now, say I want to buy a OnePlus 70. Now, did you guys see how the page refreshed? So this is what is not, it is, this is the opposite of a single page application. This is how traditional websites are made. Now let's see what a single page application looks like. Right, so keep your eyes here on the refresh icon. Now let's say I want to go to, okay, Amsterdam from 25th, 26th. Let's say it's one guest. And I say search. Do you see how this page never refreshed? It just replaced everything with new data. That's what a single page application means. So why would anyone want to create a single page application? I mean, as you noticed, I mean, if I'm clicking on 10 links and my page is refreshing over and over, then that's just not a good experience. And if I'm just changing where I am, if I'm just changing the view for the user, then it's a very smooth and seamless experience. If you've ever been on any of the single page applications, I'm sure you would have noticed the difference. Another reason why you would want to create a single page application is, so when a client, the client being your browser, when it goes to a website, what it is doing is it's sending the server a request for the web page. Correct? Now the web server responds with the HTML file, and that is what the browser renders for you. Now, for traditional websites that are not a single page application, every new page that you visit to is a new HTTP request, and the in resources are fetched every single time. Is Quora a single page application? I'm not sure. I don't use Quora a lot. Let's see. All right, I'm gonna have to log in. So, I mean, if you have an account, you can just go visit from article to article, and if you see that the page refreshes when you visit, like when you change the article, then you'll know that it is not a single page application. All right. So yeah, like I was saying, so in a single page application, what happens is the HTML is only requested once, and every subsequent request is just a data request. So when I land on Airbnb, this is the first HTML request. Every request after this, every request after I submit the form, that was just an Ajax call to fetch the data and show me the new data. So that's how you improve performance over traditional websites. Okay. So getting back to this, right? Like I said, React allows you to make single page applications without reloading the page. You can just change data in front of the user. So the experience for the user is fast, it's scalable, and it's simple. And we know that now that the internet is so ubiquitous, a nice UX is very important for someone to visit your website again, or even for them to have a nice experience throughout your website. So if that wasn't enough for you, there are a lot more reasons. I've listed some of them down here. So React follows what is called a one-way data binding. I'll go into depth during the demonstration. I'll explain a little bit more about that and how that differs from something like Angular and how that's better. Then React, so React allows you to create mobile applications as well with this other library called React Native. And React is a very big fan of reusability, which means, so React follows a component-based approach. So instead of having to write my navbar on every single page over and over, I can just create one navbar and include it in every page. That way I don't have to copy-paste the same code in every page, right? And then even the code that you, using React Native, even the code that you write on your website can be reused, some of it can be reused to make your mobile applications. Like I said, so React improves performance by making it a single page application, and how it improves performance over traditional websites and over jQuery, I'll explain that as well within a little later. We'll go in depth. Right. So I'll tell you what React does. So under the hood, what React does is, do you all know what a DOM is on the website, what DOM means? Yes, exactly. Document Object Model. That's the window and the document that the website is rendered inside. So what React does is it creates a copy of the DOM called the virtual DOM. And any changes that you make, what React does is, so let's see, I think it'll be better if I explain it with this diagram. So what React does is it makes an exact copy of the real DOM. And this red node, do you see this red node? That's the node that has changed. So for example, on a click of a button, I want to change the heading of my page. That heading is this red dot right here. Now, since nothing else has changed, I shouldn't have to re-render anything else. So that's what React does. It takes the virtual DOM and it checks what is different in the virtual DOM from the real DOM. Here, the red dot being different. And it only patches that node in the real DOM, and hence the rest of the element tree, the node tree, remains the same, untouched. Whereas something with jQuery, if you were to change the heading of the page, the whole DOM would re-render again, making the manipulations very expensive and very heavy on the user's device. So, yeah, like I said, it creates an exact copy of the DOM. It checks what is different from the virtual DOM in the real DOM, and it applies only those particular changes. So that's a basic overview about React. And if you have any, if you think we should proceed with the demonstration, can I get a yes in the chat if we should proceed with the demonstration? Or if you have any doubts about the theory? Okay, let's proceed with the demonstration then. So I'm assuming that most of you have Node and NPM installed. That would be a prerequisite to get started. Does everyone have Node and NPM installed on their system? Okay, looks like we can proceed then. For those of you who may not have Node and NPM installed, for the sake of the session, if you'd like to follow along, you can go to codesandbox.io. Sandbox.io. And you can get started there. For the rest, let's get started. Let me see. Hold on just 1 second. Yes. So come to your terminals. Open any terminal, any system that you're on. I'm on macOS. So for Windows, it would be command prompt or admin PowerShell. And for Linux, it would be just a terminal. So just from your terminal, cd into the directory you would like to make the project in. I'm just going to do it on the desktop. From there, make sure you have Node and NPM installed. After that, what you're going to need for React, and this is a simple way of setting up a React project. For small projects, this is very useful. It's a tool called Create React App. Now, Create React App is a third-party library. It's not maintained by Facebook. It has its own contributors and maintainers. So what you want to do is, first you want to say npm I minus g create React app. All right, so for me, I already, Tanuja, which part didn't you get exactly? Okay, no problem. So in your terminal, just go ahead and run this command. Npm I stands for install. It's the same, it's the shorthand for install. Minus G is for minus minus global, which means it will globally install Create React App on your terminal. So no matter what directory you're in, no matter where your terminal is open, you'll be able to use Create React App. So I already have this installed, but for the rest of you, you can just go ahead and run that. Okay, and once that's installed, as everyone following along, is everyone fine? Yes, okay. So once that's done, to create a new project, what you need to do is create React App Movie Library. And that's it. What it will do is it will install the dependencies that you need, React, React DOM, and React scripts. I'll tell you what all these do. So React is the library that we spoke about. React DOM is the one that renders your code onto the DOM and does all the diffing and everything. React scripts is a set of pre-installed scripts that will help you run a local server on your machine. And it will also set up some other tools like Webpack for minifying your code, Babel for transpiling your JSX. And basically, if you would want, you could install all of these dependencies yourself as well. But Create React App is, the idea behind Create React App is so that you don't have to worry about dependencies, maintaining the dependencies, upgrading the dependencies. You just focus on making your React application. So as you can see, it'll do everything for me. It'll set up everything for me. And then once that's done, we can go ahead and just focus on our app. All right. So now that everything's installed, create React app, command not found. Akshay, did you run npm install globally? Okay. Can you just tell me what steps you did? Can you just type that in the chat quickly? You're using VS Code, that's perfectly fine, but you ran it through the terminal, correct? So I'm guessing since are you on Linux? Windows, that's fine. So did you try running npm minus v that ran, correct? So npm install, just try npm I minus g again, npm I minus g create React app. Make sure there were no typos. Yes, I'll tell you everything about the dependencies such as Babel during the demonstration itself. It'll be much easier for you to understand that way.
Guys, if you got the questions, like I said, we'll be keeping a short 10 minutes Q&A. So yeah, hold your horses. Let the session get completed. You note down your questions and shoot it down to Ayush after he ends it. Cool? Yeah.
Okay. So now let's move into VS Code. You can use any text editor that you like. I prefer VS Code, so I'll be using that today. So just go ahead and open your project in your preferred terminal. Okay. So as you can see, Create React App did everything for me. It set up this entire project for me. Package.json is the main file here. I mean, it maintains all the dependencies that you need for your project. These are the React scripts that I was telling you about. It helps you set up a local server on your machine and everything. And these are just some other dependencies, browser list, and you can see a lookup browser list later after this session. It's not that big a deal. Source folder is where you will be writing your code. The public folder includes your index.html file. That's the only single file that will be there in your project. Okay. And yeah, so let's see. So now once you cd into the directory of the project, so if you're not already into the project, you would have to do cd movie library. Once you're inside the project directory, you can just do npm start. This is the React script that will create a local server on your machine and run your project for you. Let me just share this screen with you guys right here. Right, so can everyone see my browser? Okay, so let's see. Index.js. Index.js is where everything starts. Okay. Did everyone get their server started up? Is everyone good? Okay, let's proceed. So in index.js, let's see, let's remove all of this. So remember now everything's gone. And another thing about Webpack is there is live reload enabled. So anytime you make any changes, your web page will be reloaded immediately without you having to go and refresh it. So let's import React. This is the library that we installed. This is the package that we installed, if you remember. Let's say import React from React. We will also need to import React DOM. Okay. Now React is the main library, like I said. It will have all the keywords and JSX support and everything. And React DOM is where the virtual DOM is created and the diffing algorithm is done and everything. So now React DOM gives you a method called render. Now what we want to, what render does is you see this index.html file, you see this div called root. Inside of this div is where everything will be rendered. So let me show you. React DOM render takes two arguments, first being what you want to render. So let's say hello world. And the second being where you want to render your application. So get element by ID, and the ID was root. So as you can see here, hello world is rendered. And if I just open the terminal, the dev tools, you can see inside the root app, H1 was rendered. Okay. Now let's see what else. App test.js is for unit testing. We won't be covering that today. Service worker, we won't be covering. We'll look at, let's get rid of these files. Move to trash. Delete these. Let's delete this. Okay. Now let's see app.js. So everything in React is a function. And in React, if you want to call a function, like your component is basically a function and you're exporting this component so that it can be reused anywhere else. Okay. So now what happens is, give me a second. Okay. So now what happens here is, so now once you've exported your component, let's see, let's take your H1 from here and let's put it inside the app here. Okay, we don't need the logo. Now, once you've exported the app, wherever you want to use app, all you can do is import app from app. Okay. And whenever you want to call your component, you write it as an XML tag, which is this. So as you can see, it now says hello world, which is inside the app. And if I change it to hello app and I save it, it changes to hello app. Okay. Any doubts here? Okay, great. So let's see. All right. So let's get rid of this. Okay. And for the styling, for the CSS, there's a .cs, there's a .css file right here called app.css. There's another one called index.css. But you can use just one, or you can have separate CSS files for your separate components. So I'm just going to get rid of the index.css. I don't need that. And here I'll just get rid of all of this. Okay. So in my app, what I want first is a header. So React has different keywords from your normal HTML5. As you can notice, in HTML, it's called class, whereas in React, it's called class name. This is for React to just be... No, so you use the function name. So I imported, this is what I exported from app. Right here, export default app. The function is called app. And this is what I imported here and I used it as a tag. Yes. So yeah, class name is for React to identify its own keywords. So here it's called class name. In normal HTML, it's called class. If you do this, what it'll do is it will throw you a warning saying invalid DOM property class. Did you mean class name? So React expects a class name property. So let's call this header. In this, let's give an H1 called movie library. Okay, so as you can see, everything is refreshing on the fly. Oh, I'm just gonna say header. Yeah. 2530. I do not want. So I won't be going in depth with the CSS because we'll mainly be covering the. We will only be covering the React part of it. I hope that's fine. No, we will not be using any CSS frameworks here. We will be writing our own CSS. So just to save some time, give me a minute. Yeah, just to save some time, I'm going to take the CSS that I already have prepared. I can explain it later, the CSS part of it, if there's time left. Okay. .scss. As you guys can see, there are some issues going on. So what I did was I took my CSS and I also renamed my file to app.scss so that I can use so SCSS is basically a CSS preprocessor that allows you to do things like make variables, make for loops, have nested component styles and everything. So to be able to use SCSS, Create React App provides inbuilt support for that. All you have to do is npm install node sass as a developer dependency. So I stands for install, minus D means save it as a developer dependency. We do not want to ship this to the user. This is only for while we are developing, we need this library. So just go ahead and run that. Okay, great. Now that that's installed, let's see, let's go back into the app. We'll change it to SCSS here. And as you can see, everything's working just fine. Okay. Okay. So that's where we have our header over there. Let's proceed with the. Now, since this is a movie library, you would want users to be able to search for movies, correct? So we're just going to make a search. Input type text. Class name will be search. Okay, we do not want this in the header. We want a placeholder. Let's say search. Okay. Just so it's clear for you guys what I'm doing. So everyone's following along, right? Am I going too fast? Okay, for those of you who are following along, if you want the CSS, you can get the CSS from here. There you go. So just go ahead, copy the CSS from there, and okay. Just give me 1 second if you're not able to see the CSS.
Someone has just asked if you can please paste link. Gunish Mehta, I guess.
Yeah, I pasted the link in the chat. If you can just check the chat, I'll... I'm sorry. I was... Give me a second. I replied to someone... someone's... private message.
Select everyone and paste
it. Yes, just give me 1 second. Let me copy the link. Hold on. Right, so here you guys go. This is the link for the CSS.
Yeah, now it's there.
Does everyone have the CSS ready? Okay, great. So let's move ahead with that. We want this to be a form.
It would be great if you can just zoom in or just leave the eyes. Hello?
Yeah. Sure. Is this visible?
Yeah, it's good now. Yeah.
Yeah? Okay. So what I'll do is I'll actually hide my browser if that's okay. I'll share the browser intermittently. So that way you guys will have a better look at the code. Right? So, okay. Then what we also want is a button. Yeah, did someone say anything? Is my voice audible? Am I audible?
Yeah. You're quite audible. I guess it's it might be the learner's settings.
Okay, no problem. So
yeah, guys, we just check your setting. Yeah, if you can continue. Yeah.
So we'll create a button, we'll give it the class name. And these classes are all in the CSS. That's how I know what these are. You can customize the styles to your own liking later if you like. I'm just gonna go ahead with these. Okay, I want a form action. I'm just gonna give an X to clear the input field later. We're gonna have a select field for the user to be able to sort the movies. We're going to give it options. Let's say sort by. We want rating. And we'll sort it by release date. Give it a class name. Sort. Yeah. So can everyone see the changes happening in their browsers? Okay, you want to see my browser? Just hold on 1 second. This is what I have in my browser right now. Does everyone's code look like this? Okay. So back to the code. Yeah, so we have a select field, we have a search field. Okay, now let's make a div called grid. And this is where we will have the movie listings. Okay. Okay. So inside the grid, we'll be using the CSS grid. You can also use Flexbox, but I'll be going ahead with the grid. The code for that is already in the CSS. So you can refer to that there later. Okay. In our movie card, what we will have is, let's call it movie card. Now we want to have the poster for the movie. So we will have an image tag. We'll call it movie poster. Okay. We'll have, we obviously want to show the name of the movie, so we'll have a movie title. Okay, let's say title. And now we want to show the rating for the movie. So we'll get onto that a little later. We'll make a separate component for that ourselves. Okay, so let's actually just go ahead and do that right now. So let's see. Inside the source folder, I want to make a new file called rating.js. Okay. I want to import React from React. Now here, we don't need to include React DOM like we did in the index.js file because this is just the JavaScript code. This has here, we won't be writing any render part. That's been taken care of here. Okay, so let's make a function called rating. Now, as you know, functions accept parameters, and in React, components accept parameters called props. Now, what props are is basically it's a way of passing data to your components so that in your reusable components, you can have you can reuse them in multiple places and still have dynamic data in the components. So we also want to export the function. You can either write export directly here, or you can also write it export default rating in this manner. It's the same thing. So what a function does in React is it returns HTML, for example, a div or anything. Okay. So what we want here is we want to show as many stars as there are in the rating. The parameter we will pass to rating will be the number of stars that we want to show. So now what rating looks like, basically out of the box, props will be look like something. It'll be an object. I can pass say rating. I want to say rating is 5. I want to say any other data that I want to pass, props will be an object. So if I want to use anything here, say I want to show what I've passed here. So I'll just say props.rating. Let's just do this for now so that it's more clear to you guys. Now that we've exported rating here, we're going ahead and we'll import rating from rating. Don't forget, no typos. We want to show the rating here. Okay. So if you guys can see, if I do this, it only says title because we haven't included an image. We haven't really passed any rating. So I'm just going to go ahead and pass the rating. So in rating, like I said, I want to pass a rating. And how I know that this is going to be the name for the parameter is because this is how I am accepting it. I want a variable named rating inside the props. Okay. So I want to say rating is going to be 5. This movie has 5 rating. Now, when I save that, if you go to your browser, you will see 5 is rendered here. Okay. Now, if you go back to the code, if I copy another rating and I say 10, or instead of that, let me copy the entire movie card. Let's call this title 2. Let's make this rating 10. Okay. You go back to your browser and you'll see there'll be a title 1, there will be a title 2, and there will be rating 10. So this is how you pass different data to the same component. As you can see, I've used the rating twice without having to rewrite that code, but I still have different data here. Okay. So let's go back to rating. Now in ES6 syntax, what you can do is if you know what you're getting in the object, like I said, props is an object. You don't have to write props.rating, props.this, props.that every single time. What you can do is write it in this manner. This is called object restructuring. So I know props has a variable called rating, which I want to use. So I can just write it this way so that it's more convenient. And when I save that and go back to my browser, you'll see that it still works. Okay. So what we want to do is we want to render as many stars as there is number of ratings. So what you can do is you can create a new array. I'll say array. I want to have that many empty elements in this as there are as the value of the rating. Okay. Now I want to get the keys of the array because the array that is created here is an empty array. So we want the keys. So I'll show it to you here so that it's more clear. So if you just open up a console and you write array of say rating is 5, you see it creates an array of 5 empty elements, but we want to run a for loop on this array so that we can render 5 stars. So a neat trick is what you can do is you can say array and take the keys of the array. And you can create an array from that. Now this syntax, these triple dots is the spread operator in JSX, again, ECMAScript 6. So what this does is it takes this array and it puts these elements into a new array that are created here, as you can see from these square brackets. So it created an array with numbers 0 to 4. And it has 5 elements, and that's what the rating that we passed it. So let's go back and do this. So we wrap it in an array. We make the keys. Now dot map is a function that is used to loop over the arrays. You cannot use a for loop in React here for rendering HTML because you need to return some HTML. So what dot map does, it returns something. So that's why we use dot map here. What this dot map will do is it will iterate over every key. And this is the same as writing. I don't really want to go over ECMAScript because that would take some time. So you can either write this or you can simply make an arrow function that returns some HTML. So let's say we want to return a div, and that div will have, we want to render the value of key. Okay. So if we do that, we've passed rating 5 and 10 here. And if we go back to our browser, we will notice that it renders all elements from 0 to 1 and 0 to 9. Okay, there's an error which says, there's a warning which says every element in a list should have a unique key. Now, what a key in React is basically, you see this div that I've created. Now, React considers this a list. So for React to uniquely identify each item in the list so that if only one single item in the list updates, like I said, remember the diffing algorithm, it updates only what has changed. So for React to uniquely identify what has changed, it requires a key prop. Now to avoid confusion, we will make this value. Okay. And instead of rendering the value, what we want to do is we want to render stars. Okay. So the API that we will be using for movies gives rating out of 10, but we want to show rating out of 5. So we will also be accepting something called the default base here, which will be by default 10, I think. Yeah, because the movie library passes a rating out of 10, and we want a new base of 5 because we want to show the value out of 5. So before we do any, before we show any stars over here, we'll just calculate what the new rating will be out of the, so for the new rating out of 5, what the new rating will be the default rating, which is rating divided by the default base, what it will have multiplied by the new base. Okay. This is just, maths. I don't want to go into explaining that. Now what dot map does, it iterates over single elements, and it also gives another argument called index. So what we want to do here is for this div, if the index of the value of the current value, so for example, rating is 4, correct? So we'll be mapping over rating, and if rating is less than the index that we want, then we want to show a filled star. Otherwise, we want to show an empty star. Does that make sense? So we map over this. Okay. We want to make it inside a div. We call it rating. Okay. Now, there's some error here. Okay. That's fine. So yeah, if the index of the current value, we don't need the, because here the value and the index is the same, we don't really need that. And this is an error because, so to, if you want to write JavaScript inside of HTML in React, what you need to do is you need to wrap it in curly braces. Okay. So since the value and the index here is the same, we don't really need the index. So inside the div, see, we want to render a star. Let's take a star from here. We can paste a star inside the div. Okay. So now if you check your browsers, as you can see, it's rendering stars, but it's rendering them one below the other, and it's also rendering the string, which is not what we want. So the reason for that is, because we're rendering the strings here, what we want to check is if the new rating, and like I said, this is a JavaScript condition, so this will have to be inside a curly brace. Okay, so we want to say if the current index, the current value, if it's less than the new rating, then we want to render a filled star. Otherwise, we want to render an empty star. Okay. You can get the ASCII characters for the stars online if you just Google. If you just Google HTML ASCII value, you can just get that here. So yeah, this is a ternary operator. So if the value of the current item in the array is less than the new rating, then we want this star. Otherwise, we want this star. Okay. Okay, let's move on here. So let's get rid of this movie card. Now I'm going to be changing this function to a class component. I'll tell you why. So the reason for that is in React, there is something called a state, and functions do not have state. So state is basically where you store the local data for the component. So for example, I'll store my state here, and state is an object. Okay, and this is where we will be storing all the movie data, and we will be accessing it here and writing it in a loop so that we don't have to write this part of the HTML over and over again. So in a function directly returns the HTML, whereas a class, what a class does it renders something. The render method, what that does, the render method is what returns the HTML for this. So you put the return inside the render. Okay. And if you go back to your browser, this still works. Okay. So here's your title. Now, before we move on, so that it's, let's, you guys can go ahead in your browser and type TMDB API. Okay, so you'll see the movie database. This is what we'll be doing, using to get the data for the movies. If you go to movies and go to developers.themoviedatabase.org, okay, so what you'll have to do is you'll have to sign up here, and you will have to go and request for an API key. So once you get the API key, that's how you will be able to make API requests to the database and get the data for the movies from here. Okay, so since that will take you guys some time, what I'll do is, just give me 1 second, I'll share my key with you guys, and I'll revoke that later. So just give me 1 second.
Ayush, suddenly your voice, is not clear.
Oh, okay. Is it fine right now? If I speak louder, is that fine? Is that better?
Ayush, there's some problem with the voice.
Hello.
It's clear when you spoke.
Yeah, it's clear.
Yeah, it's good now. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So as I was saying, just give me 1 second. I will share my
It's good now.
Key with you.
Yeah, it's good now. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So. Meanwhile, if anyone has any questions, please feel free to ask. I'll just share the API key with you guys in a second. Okay, so everyone can just use this key for now. This will be your API key. This is what we need to send to the movie database along with our API requests, so that they can identify us as legitimate users. Okay. So I'm going to go here and I'm going to make a new file called api.js. Now there is another dependency that we want to install. It's called Axios. What Axios allows us to do is it allows us to make API requests, and it allows us to create an instance where we can set default settings, such as the token that I just shared in the header, and we can set the base URL so that we don't have to do it every time we make a request. We can just do it once. So here we're going to import Axios from Axios. We're going to export an Axios instance. And here, what we want to say is we want the base URL. The base URL for the movie database is, hold on. This is the base for the movie database /3. We want to set some params. This will be the API key. And this is the API key that I just shared with you guys. So now every time we make a request, our request will be made to this URL and it will send this key automatically. So we don't have to write it over and over again. Okay. So let's import API from API. Now in a React component, there is something called component lifecycle, which is basically, as the name suggests, when the component mounts onto the DOM, you can do something inside this method. So here we're going to make the API call, which is api.get. And if I simply just do this and go to my browser is okay. Let me find my browser. Give me a second. Yes. So my browser is here. Okay. So if you go to the network tab and you refresh the page, you will see this is the API call that we made. As you can see, it was made to that URL. And for some reason, it didn't pass the headers. So the problem here is with Axios. The latest version of Axios does not allow you to set default parameters into your requests. So you can come here and install Axios at a particular version, which is 0.18. Yeah, so now that's done. If we go back to the browser, and we refresh the page. Okay, since we updated a dependency, what we will have to do is just stop this server and we'll restart the server. Okay, let me just share my browser with you guys. There we go. And if I refresh the page, you see the network. The API request was made to this and the API key was sent along as a parameter in the request. Okay, So this is how we will be making requests to the movie database and getting the results for that. So let's see, we want to get movies and we want to get popular movies. Now let's see what this does. Go back to the browser, open up the network tab, and refresh the page. This is what it returned. This is the data that it gave me, and this result, these are all movies. Now, if you can see, each object for a movie, it has a vote count, it has a release date, it has the overview for the movie, it has the poster path. Okay, so we'll be accessing all of this data, but to access this data, we need to store it somewhere. And remember the state, the storage for the component that I told you, this is where we will be storing the data. Now, the .get in Axios, another good thing about Axios is in .fetch. Now, since the response is in JSON, you would need to pass the JSON, but Axios already parses it for us and gives it to us. So we just take the response. We take response.data.results. This is what we need. And if we just console.log the thing. And if you're wondering how I know what it's called, Axios, it's the response object is always a response.data. And inside that, you can see the key is called results. So if you go to your console, as you can see here, all the movies were listed down here. Okay. Now for these movies, you can see that this is an array. So I will store it in my state. Now to store it in the state, React gives you a function called this.setState. Now, what is this here? This is basically this class. It is the context for this class. For React to know which class I'm talking about, this is what this means. And the state, what we want to do is we want to say movies to response.data.result. Okay, so inside the state, React will make an array of movies after fetching it from the API. Now we can simply have an empty array here, and we could have simply done this dot state dot movies equal to the result. That's how you do change the value of a variable. But if you do that, React will not know that you've changed the state. So for React to know that you've changed the state, and so that React can run its diffing algorithm, you have to use the set state function, and the movies is what we will be setting into the state. Now, remember I was telling you, we wouldn't have to write this logic over and over again. So this is where the magic happens. We say this dot state dot movies. We map over the array. We take a single movie and we return this HTML to it. So if I keep my HTML the same, if I don't give it the movie data that we receive from this, you go back to the browser and you'll notice that there's an error. It says cannot read property map of undefined. And that's because when we are here, because when the component loads, movies doesn't exist. Okay, movies is undefined. That's why it's saying it cannot read the property map. So let me see what's wrong. This looks fine. Okay. So now from this movie, like I said, this movie again is an object that we are getting from the movie database. So if we come back here and we see what's inside a particular movie, so this is the one movie that we will be like at a time we'll be mapping over. So the title for this movie is Ad Astra. Now we want to display the title for the movie instead of the default text that we've written here, title. So for this, we know that movie has something called title. For the poster, again, since that's a variable, you cannot have just single quotes. You'll have to write every piece of JavaScript inside curly braces. This will be movie.poster path. You can refer to all these variables in the network tab that you see. Okay. Rating will be movie.voteCount. It's vote average. It gives both, but we'll be using vote average. Now, like I told you, the movie is out of 10, so we have to tell our component that the default base is 10. And the new base, we don't need to pass a new base as 5 because we've defined default value for that here. Okay. So now this will render a list of all the movies along with the posters and everything. Let me just give me 1 second. It's still saying cannot read property of undefined. So here is you guys will get an idea about if you run into such an error, how to debug it as well. So now that I've stored the values here, what you can do is you can, so the set state function takes a second parameter, which is a callback function. So what happens is the set state is an asynchronous function. So if I write a console log simply outside, this may happen sometimes after the set state and sometimes before the set state. But what we want is we want to run that function after the state has been set. And that's why I'll be writing it in the callback function. And I'll be console logging the state here. Okay. We define the state, we define component in mount. This state.movies.map. So this console logs fine. What we need to do is okay. So before the API call is made, the value for this dot say dot movies is undefined. That's why you can't map over that. So what and does in React is it conditionally renders. It checks whether this dot shade dot movies exist. If this value is true, and this value is always true because this is a static expression. So if this is true, then this will happen. If this is false, then this will not happen. It will straight up say false. Okay. So now, let's go ahead and just Okay, so since we do not have a lot of time to cover the cover all the parts for the project, for the follow along coding, what I'll do is I'll just walk you through the code and I will walk you through the code. You'll have the code available to you later as well. Okay, so let's go to movie library. You can view the code here. I've shared the code with you here. Yes, Deepanshu, your questions will be answered. Just 10 minutes, I'll walk you through the project and then we'll have a Q&A session. Okay, so if you visit the repository, you will find it here, and it's the same same folder structure as it was in your code. So if you go to app.js, here you'll notice again, like the state, we were at the movies part. We loaded the movies. There's a separate function for movies here. It's again calling the movie library, and then it's setting the movies into the state. This is where we were, and that's when you map over the movies and you render your movie card right here. Okay, so once you write this, you are giving the default values to for example the movie path, the movie title, and the movie vote average. This is our rating component. Once the movies are loaded, and do not remember the key prop. This key is very important for React to uniquely identify the elements in a list. Now, the search field that we had, the form. Now in React, React allows you to, like I said, the keywords in React are different. In normal HTML, this would just be on submit without the capital S, but here it's camel case. So what you say is on submit, you want to run this function, handle search. So what React does is it passes the event parameter to the handle search function. Now, since we do not want the page to reload on the submission of the form, we just say event.prevent default. Now, when the form is submitted, that is the query that we need to pass the TMDB to give us the search results for that movie. For example, if I search for Avengers, then we need to pass the keyword Avengers to the movie database for it to return results that contain Avengers in the title. So for that, what you have to do is they have an endpoint called search and movie, and you don't have to worry about the rest of the URL or passing the token, because that we already set in the Axios instance. So you just pass the query to the movie database, and it returns you the results with all the movies that contain the parameter that the user wrote in the input field. Okay. So, and then we also have some sorting options here. So you can sort the movies by the rating, or you can sort the movies by the year. So on React also gives another method called onChange. So every time the value for the select field changes, so you guys can also see the demo here. The link for the demo is provided in the repository itself. So what the onChange function does is anytime the value of the input field changes, we run a function. Okay, so you guys can go here, go into app.js, and you can see that on change of this value, I want to run the handle sort function. What the sort function does is it basically takes the movie array and it sorts it according to the parameter that we want to sort it via. This is just plain JavaScript function, except the set state. Here, the dot sort is a vanilla JavaScript function that you should be familiar with. So as you can see, only the data flow and the way you call functions is different in React. For example, on change, I want to run this function. On click, I want to run this function. On click, I want to do something here. But anything and everything that you write inside the function is just plain vanilla JavaScript. Okay, this is how functions are called in React. Now, another thing that we want to do here is this is not enough information for the user to know about the movie. So if you click on the movie, we want to open a modal, which will show you other details like the overview for the movie, the release date and everything. So for that, you can pass an onClick to the div, and onClick, what you want is to get these other details about the movie. You need to pass to the movie database, the ID of the movie. Now, since we are mapping over this movie, we have the movie.id available to us. So we can just set that. And if you see here, we've used a modal, and remember I spoke about passing properties to it. So here we are setting the state, we are setting the movie ID of the movie that is clicked, and we are accessing that same movie ID over here, and we're passing it to the modal. Now what the modal does is, if you can go back and you can check modal. Now you see every time I click the movie, the modal opens and it's the same modal. I didn't have to do anything. I don't have to change anything. Every time the modal is rendered, you get the ID that you passed it via the props. Here, this dot props dot movie ID. Now this ID, you pass it to the movie database along with your URL. And you get the result, and you get the rest of the data, and you can set that data into the state and access. And there are like 10 fields that you can access, but here I've only used 4, the overview, the tagline, the release date, and the genres. So there's a lot more data that you can use and display. So if you go through the code, it's pretty self-explanatory here. Now, for example, if a movie does not have a tagline, then we do not want to render an empty H5 here or something like undefined being rendered inside. Or if I have a margin to the H5, that since the div will still be rendered, the margin will take up space. So like I told you before, conditional rendering, what it checks is if there is a tagline, then render this. Otherwise, do not render it. Okay. So one more thing is, now while your API call, for some people who are on a slow network, what will happen is the API call can take some time to do. So what you can do is, before you make the API call, you can set a flag called loading is true. Okay. So now if you go here, when I'm loading more data, you see this loader that came. Yeah. So this is what this loading flag does. Now, when I'm setting it true before the API call and after I've received the data, I set loading to false. Now, what happens here is, if you see, for the button, I've given a condition. If loading is true, then I want to show the loader. Otherwise, I want to show the button. So now, in normal HTML, you would just show hide this, but that's not what happens in React. If I inspect the button here, you see there's this button. If I click on it, it goes away. There's a loader. If you could see it for a split second, there's a loader and then the button comes off. So the node is actually removed from the DOM itself completely and then re-rendered onto the DOM. Okay. So this is where the on change happens. If I say Avengers here and I submit the form, then it searched for Avengers. You can see all the network calls here. If I say Hitman and I press search, so you can see that it searched the movie for the query Hitman. This is what we sent it and this is what it returned. See, these are all the results. And I told you there are so many fields that you can access. When you open a modal, see, it sent the movie ID. It sent the movie ID specifically and got the data for that movie. And there are so many fields that you can access, but I've only accessed four here just to keep it simple. Okay, so the code is available to you at the link that I sent. You can go through it. I've covered most of the basic concepts so that you won't get stuck while reading this code. And yeah, I think that pretty much sums up the session for right now. We can have the Q&A session now.
Thanks, Ayush. Guys, you all can just, ping your questions to Ayush if you had any. So we have a good 5 to 6 minutes. We can use that.
Best resources for learning a lot. You can go to the React.js. Sorry. You can go to react.js.org. Their docs are very good. For video tutorials, you can just go to YouTube. This channel called Traversy Media. That's a very good channel. Code Academy is a very good channel. And I'm sure GreyAtom will also have their own tutorials as well, which will be outstanding.
The Panchu and the other guys, I would like to tell you that since you guys are interested in React, this our program, the front-end engineering program that I spoke of, is based on JavaScript and React. So since the Panchu, you asked video tutorials, other docs, why don't you just go on our website, check about this. Like I said, the program is free, no upfront fee. Yeah, thanks. Ayush, you can continue.
Yeah, and Dipanshu, since there you will be having live sessions and a mentor teaching you, I think it'll be a much better experience, because if you have any questions, those will be resolved. Whereas on a YouTube video, I mean, you'll have to go through and scour through the internet to answer your own questions and everything.
That's absolutely correct. I couldn't agree with you, Ayush. Yeah, the same problem happens in video tutorials. In a live mentoring session, you'll have, your mentor to solve your questions or doubts. But in video tutorials, you just need to follow what's going on. So that's the difference. Yeah. Any more questions, guys? Cool then. I think then we are good to end this. Ayush, thanks for this wonderful session.
Thanks a lot.
Log on to GreyAtom's learning platform to unlock more free content. Subscribe to our channel and hit the bell icon for regular updates.